Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another Archon's Corner. Today I got myself, Dr. Sheep, and with me I got Big Z.
Hey, hey.
And Ewok Jr.
Hello, KeyForge community.
And sadly, the Wookiee has real life again, so he won't be with us today, but he'll be back next week, I think.
All right, so I think Ewok's going to start us off. Ewok, you played some sealed online KeyForge this week, and you might have sucked. So share with us why that might be the case.
Oh, I definitely had some issues this week. We were playing DT sealed, or I was playing DT sealed. This was on our Tuesday night chainbound. And whole bunch of decks, DT actually did hold up for me. So I know a lot of people kind of pushing. You'll hear a little bit competitive elements from DT later. But I definitely had one of those moments. Good shout out to our good friend Cloggin. And both of us were coming in. This was round number four. And both decent decks. We're both at two keys, pushing for that third key. And I look at my hand. I have a nice archive that's been set up with quite a few Unfathomable. And I also have Starlines and Logos. And at this point, Cloggin has pushed me to check. And I look at my hand and go, yes, I can take him off check with my Logos. I can play Edai and basically push another card into archive. And it will be just one or two above. I can go ahead and play Starlines, and Volmar is going to keep me above. Or I can go ahead and play my Unfathomable. And I had, it was some random, what was it? Caddick. It was basically a play capture two. If you go ahead and turn the tide, you can play capture two. Yeah. And I have a big archive that is well set up with my Unfathomable. And I figure the killer punch is coming right here. I'm going to go ahead and lean in with that Unfathomable. And I pull it all back. And I start playing, and I'm literally about halfway through, and I look over and go, you've got to be kidding me. I can't raise the tide, which is the capture two mechanic that I needed, because it's already high tide for me. So I played a sweet hand of probably a good 8-9 cards, and Cloggin walked away because I couldn't take him off of the check that he had, which was just needing to be able to raise it by one. So be aware, boys and girls, that tide, you can't just go ahead and look. I mean, I did see I had options. I had options in all three houses. Two of them, I didn't even have to think about doing anything with the tide, but I went with cards. I went with that delta of, you know, I can play more cards. I can really gain the advantage here, push. Honestly, all of the other houses, Star Alliance, I could have taken them off check and gotten to check myself. I could have gone ahead and with Logos, gone ahead and taken him off check and reaped to be able to get to check. But I just went for what should have been the big play in my head. And yet it ended up costing me. And unfortunately, Cloggin was on a conference call. He bounced out the last like minute, and he wasn't even there to harass me and to say how poor of a KeyForge player I was. But there it is, KeyForge community. This is why I suck at KeyForge this week.
All right. Well, we always appreciate these stories that are shared in such vein. What doesn't kill us makes us stronger, right? Like, we just keep learning from our mistakes. Eventually, we'll stop making the mistakes, in theory. That said, I know I've made some mistakes that we've talked about in the cast. Every time one of them catches me, I'm like, huh, well, I guess I need to go listen to our own cast. So, to clarify, one thing you did mention, you specifically went out of your way to say you were on Dark Tidings for the sealed. I know we changed our sealed event just a little bit, not too long ago. Does it matter what set you play now?
No, and that was actually the great piece. I was seeing quite a bit of MM, but I played Worlds Collide MM. I did have one round that was a bye, but there was quite a bit. Dan, I don't know if you remember all the sets that were there, but I have seen across the last couple of weeks, we've had people playing Coda, we've had people playing Worlds Collide, we've had quite a bit of MM and DT. And so to see that, people are really fearful of DT and how it's interacting. But I have actually done very, very well. And this deck was not great. It was, I want to say it was a 63 SAS, what was rated. But being able to see potential synergies, be able to play what my outs were, DT did hold its own, and so I've been very happy with that. The previous week I went, I was at 3-0. I think we played three rounds in that one, and that was my DT. Now that was a little bit more of a hot deck. That was in the 70s for the SAS, and that deck did have some spice. But I have been pretty successful with DT against MM. Early on, that was not the case, but I think for me, I've started to kind of figure out. But yeah, we're definitely seeing all the sets show up, which is awesome.
Yeah, they're in our online play groups. People who play MM get made fun of because they're sick of losing, right? Oh, you're sick of losing, so you're playing MM. But Dark Tidings is consistently finishing on top, or second at worst, even when there are multiple MM decks showing up in the field.
At the risk of angering the SAS god, it could just be the SAS isn't right where it needs to be yet.
Sealed, like now you're talking about 60, mid-60s average SAS.
That's true.
Right, and in that realm, Dark Tidings is very consistent in delivering mid-60 SAS stacks, right? So you don't get the 50s stinkers.
Which is what I was saying early on about when people started doing the AOA comparisons. Like, I played a ton of AOA Sealed, and it is literally the only form of KeyForge I've ever just, like, straight up boycotted. Like, I won't do it anymore because I got so many decks that did nothing. Like, they didn't do anything well or fun consecutively. Like, I run in strings where, like, I'd get deck after deck after deck that had zero A or some other huge glaring issue. Really haven't had that experience in DT. I think, like, a lot of people are picking up that a lot of them either are missing, like, some C or some A to be, like, high-level competitive. But I've never ran into a deck that's, like, just sucked at both. And I've definitely ran into that in AOA.
And I think that's the PC, is that you were noticing in AOA there were multiple decks that had literally very limited 1 to 2 A. And, it just, the Amber control was not there. And that really had an impact. Here, DT has some issues, especially with scaling Amber. You have principle. You have some control, but overall, it's not missing multiple pieces. Yeah. It just kind of falls this mid-tier, but it doesn't end up being super competitive. But I also don't find it as bad as people are really arguing it is.
No, I don't think it is either. And like I said, I've been to a vault in AOA where I got three decks, and the highest A deck I had was 2.8 out of three decks. it's rough. DT, mathematically, there's a chance to do that in any set, but it is very hard to do that in any other set than AOA. Just based on the numbers, where the data is showing that the cards do different things.
I have definitely found a lot of lack of C. That's where I've been, like, consistently in Dark Tidings. Mm-hmm. My C is not that. There's just not enough creature control.
I found it just to be polarized as far as whether it has C. It either has very lacking C or a ton of it. Like,
it's got no
good board stuff, or it has Maelstrom, Gak, Selective, Mind Over Matter, all in the same deck. It's like, okay.
I will say Gak has been playing it is an absolute all-star card for something it was good. I saw its potential, but man, that card time and time and time again from DT when we're playing in ABR, where the opponent I had two of them, and I was able to watch out for it, but you can only play so hard in you're temperamental around it.
There's not a lot you can do.
Correct.
Except, like, Red Alert. Like, you just got to play the cards.
Correct.
You're either going to get gacked or not. Like, well, all right. Anyway, we're out of order. Some of this stuff we're going to talk about again in a second. So let's take a moment to do some updates. KeyForge Live is rocking and rolling, but before we get into some of the updates for that, our GoFundMe has been live. We advertised it a couple places again. That's just supporting the people that are putting it on. The event's going to happen. It's going to be great, no matter whether you support us or not in that endeavor financially. But if you do, it will lessen the burden on, the three of us and other associates quite a bit. But we are going to do some shout-outs. So thank you for the public donations presented to us by Luxury Playstyle, Draskor, and Julie July. Thank you for supporting all that we do on both this cast and for what we're going to do in KeyForge Live, which is to get people back at the table playing this game that we talk about every week and we love to play. We truly do love the game, hence we're putting a lot of our time, resources, money, whatever we have, so that you all can come play KeyForge and hang out with us.
Yeah, I want to go ahead and second that and say a huge thank you. But it also helps to inspire us because we're not only putting our own money, but we're also looking at this. How can we make this extra special? How can we make it fun? Even when I met up with Wookie and Dan on Tuesday, I heard about something super cool that was, you know, kind of teased. And, you know, there was a piece that came up today as we're looking, and I'm like, well, it's an extra 120 for me to be able to put this so that it's fun. All right. Yeah. You know, when you see that option, yeah, there's a price tag. I do have my wife who was over there, like, but the end result is I put in there, I want this to be all my group of friends, all the people who I haven't met yet, but are still KeyForge friends. We're going to have a blast. And so we're making it special. We're making it as Vault Tour-esque as possible. But we're just having a blast and we're going ahead and putting our money. So by your donations, it does help us to go and, you know, feel encouraged that we're doing the right thing. We do have some really nice numbers coming out and we want to keep that going. So we appreciate all the help again from each of those individuals.
For sure. For sure. All right. So updates, as far as updates go, we have almost 30 people pre-registered. I say pre-registered. There's only one way to register right now, and that's online through our web portal. So there are 30 people that have already registered, and I think it's only really been up for a little bit around 2 weeks, depending on when this comes, maybe a little bit more than 2 weeks, based on when you're listening. One of our biggest goals from when we first started this, we knew it was going to be expensive. We already had secured a venue. We'd already made plans to do this, and we talked about goal numbers a long time ago. And our biggest thing was to make sure that we hit a certain number. What number were we talking about, guys?
2,000.
Yes.
Well, we do have biggest a cap of two
card events. No,
we do have a cap of 250 at the event. So again, that is our dream. But no, our goal was 50. And to see 30 pre-registered in roughly 2 weeks, guys, that is awesome. And I know people keep, like, even though our numbers are still at that 30 mark, we have people who have reached out like, hey, we're taking this amount from our crew. We're taking this amount from our crew. So we want to continue to encourage
registered
you.
Yet. So for us to get as accurate as a count as we can quickly, we're going to kind of do a little promo. We posted this on Facebook this morning, I think. This is Thursday morning. So to try to get our goal of 50 by July 4th, which would be a lot of people pre-registered, we know people are going to show up and pay the day of, that's great too. We're going to give everyone that registers between now and July 4th, I think it's somewhere around noon on July 4th. Registered by July 4th, a chance to win something pretty cool. At least I think it's going to be really cool. We are making several tapestry banner type things that will be hung at the event. They'll say KeyForge Live. It'll be orange along with our KeyForge official logo and the Archon head looking thing, which I think is pretty neat. Especially once you look at it, it looks like kind of trippy, the shadowed ones. There's an image of that up on Facebook. So anyone that is already registered and registers between now and July 4th will be entered in a raffle drawing to take that home with them when they leave the event once we're all wrapped up and done. So you get a chance to win that if you are one of the people that has already registered or registers between now and July 4th. I think that's all of that promo thing, so it should be a little fun thing to keep. What do you think of that, Dan? Would you want to win a gigantic or 50 by 60 inch KeyForge Live tapestry?
I want one so bad, I'm just buying one for myself.
This is true. I also want one so bad, I am buying one directly since it's our thing and I would like a memento of what we did this summer.
They are super cool, guys. I mean, there's no question about it. And that's why we're throwing it up as a little incentive. So come join us and have some fun.
And then I think we might have some kind of stream or video to share what that drawing looks like that comes out either on the 4th or shortly after. So look for that to go up somewhere on the KeyForge webs around or shortly after July 4th.
I'm also planning that when my wife finds how much I spent on this, I might be living under it as a legal.
I told my wife as we went, like, my Father's Day present this year, along with my birthday present, which is in September, is simply going to be for her to do her best to ignore all of the mini transactions that are flying out of her account this summer. And just say, this is my new summer job. It makes negative dollars per hour. It's great. All right. KFPL updates. Switching to that before we get into our competitive Dark Tidings piece today. The final season 3 qualifier for the KFPL is this Sunday. It is short adaptive, 12 p.m. Eastern time over there on the KFPL servers. So if you have not yet claimed your spot, head over there, get signed up, play some short adaptive KeyForge. It's best of 1 6-round Swiss, and 4-2 or better makes it. So there is no top cut. Oh, no. 5-1 or better makes it. Definitely not 4-2. 5-1 or better makes it, so no top cut or anything like that. Just 6 rounds, nice and short and quick. And then we will be finalizing our 64-person Season 3 5-deck survival season for the KFPL. Dan's already in it. Ewok, you going to play in that?
Unfortunately, I cannot. I have multiple events. I was helping someone else on our team who's looking at decks. I love short adaptive. But I think there were 3 different events. So what people don't know is that my daughter just turned 6 yesterday. So happy birthday, Emery. Big shout out to you. And we had a little gathering with one young lady who couldn't make the party. But Saturday is the party. And then Sunday is with my parents. And so it's just that time of year where I have church, parents. There's a couple other things in real life. So I'm going to be shouting on all of the AC team and anyone else who's playing. So have a blast. But I unfortunately cannot play myself.
Yeah. Is oddly the single, like, I you can sort of like know where you're at with different styles of keyboards, right? As far as how you are competitively, short adaptive is by far the thing that I am the worst at. Like, I am real bad at that. Just am. So it is what it is. All right. DT competitive elements. So we're talking about Dark Tidings and what is competitive about it, how it stands, where it's at. So that's where we're at. So we've already talked in depth about how we feel about Dark Tidings as far as compared to other sets. We even mentioned it again today. So let's talk about what is competitive and what that's standing up to and what's not. So, Dan, what have you... you mentioned there's some pretty good things going on in the sealed events. So you've got to see a lot of this. What are you finding is kind of working for Dark Tidings for you?
What I see is working best in Dark Tidings for me is the Amber Burst. Like, I don't think mm-hmm. there is another set that has as often consistent Amber Burst that I feel like I'm seeing in Dark Tidings. And that probably comes from the amount of crosshouse cheating where you're getting value from mm-hmm. everything all the time. But there are a lot of games where I'm at 12 to 15 Amber by, you know, mid-turn games, like turn 6, turn 7, and mm-hmm. I'm just bursting way out. And because it's Dark Tidings, you don't worry that much about it.
Yeah.
Although on this last sealed event, half the field had Doorstep to Heavens and made me real sad.
Yeah.
Which I'm glad you brought up the burstiness of it, because like initially when we saw the set, we were talking about those set analytics, we all saw that there's a bunch of pips and bursts and recursion in Untamed, and we're like, wow, this is a super bursty house. But now that we've played it more, I think Sanctum is just as bursty with the Strange Order of Nations, just the different ways you can trigger the guy that reaps for armor, a Urien and Larry the Lake. Then I think there's Free Markets and Cleansing Wave too.
Yep.
I want to say that both of those are in there. Like, I feel like there's a lot. Oh, there's also that new rare that I've never pulled in any deck, the one that gets more amber for neighbors down the line and keeps going.
Yeah,
like Harmonic Ritual.
That's 3 different bursty cards, 4 different bursty cards. One that requires a combo that has to be on the board, but that is a lot of amber generation, and it's from Sanctum, which also has a lot of control. And then the third one that we didn't really see when we were doing the analytics, But now that I've played it a lot, I 100% agree with what Andrew said. He's talking about a lot of house cheating. Specifically, that is, there's some from the phase shift and theory or conjecture with Logos, but most of that's going to come out of your Star Alliance. Like your Star Alliance, the fact that you can land a diplomat, that you can use Unity or Discord to play multiple your creatures multiple times. You can play the guy, the basically the Ghost Hog guy, CR Officer Hawkins. Being able to land him twice for four in the same turn is really easy in a lot of decks with Unity or Discord. And if you have a upgrade to go on top of them as you're doing that, that's six amber. Like Star Alliance, Untamed, and Sanctum all burst amber really, really fast.
The Triska in there too. Like
I forgot about Triska. Like
so many dollars out of Triska.
Yeah, like Triska plus Diplomat, Triska plus Taper. There's so many things that are happening that are on the burst level, and like there's more things we can talk about combo driven with the Triska, but like that's all equating to your space dollar phrase. And that's outside of Logos, which still has the phase shift, the theory conjecture, the think twice. It can do all that too. I don't see Logos bursting quite as hard as often as the other three, unless it has Rooftop. Decks that have Logos with Rooftop also burst out of nowhere, because they also have those action cards I just named, plus all their scientists come in reaping, which gets a little bit absurd.
Yeah, so I feel like Logos, on our big, we were really hoping for some crazy Logos, and I haven't felt it. It's been okay. You know,
I've
like
seen decks that are almost there, right, but they just didn't get there.
There's still some really good triple Eddy Logos lines out there that do really good things. Mm-hmm. But our dream, I'm going to just data forge three times and close this game out on turn three, hasn't been found.
I have a deck that's close, but again, like it's one of those decks that does have the C-hole. It doesn't have like enough creature control. If my opponent just runs away with the game on the board, I can't stop it. It does have a win con of data forging three times, and I have done it. It's not all in the same turn, though. Like, it's data. I can fire data forge, I can forgive the data forge, and the next turn I can fire data forge, and I can think twice the data forge. So it takes setup. It's super telegraphed, but the deck doesn't really have enough C to do that against top tier MM board decks or whatever. And if they have Design, I'm just host. GG. Good game. Shake hands. Walk away. Like, it's just over. So like that's what I've experienced as far as some of that combo stuff. But like, I think the speed of the amber speed, not the actual tempo speed, is really good. And that's one of the things that, which we mentioned yesterday, that makes it, in my mind, I love playing Dark Titans versus Dark Titans, whether it's Sealed or Archon, actually, because I've been to a few of those now. I think it's a lot of fun. I did not think that was fun. Even today, when there are great AOA decks out there, there are really fun ones. There are also some very, very miserable AOA decks out there that are really good. when I go to an AOA versus AOA event or week of a league, we know we're going to see Jinka. We know we're going to see Brig, Drummernaut, and Heart. Like, that's it. That's really it. Maybe, like, some Ronnie Recursion. Dan has a great deck that doesn't use any of those, like, janky elements. But he also has two decks that do. So, I don't know. All right.
Well, I want to kind of bump in, because there's one other piece that I think hasn't been talked about in regards to speed. When we're looking at MM decks, I think that one of the pieces that's extremely important is you're actually looking at the tide mechanic. So the number of cards that manipulate tide versus the number of cards that use tide. And there are a number of cards that has a lot of uses tide effects, but has very, very, very little manipulates tide.
Yep.
And so if that happens and you have a low speed, that deck, in my opinion, that deck most of the time is completely overrated. So the idea of actually having a close manipulates tide to uses tide is extremely important. There's also a lot of cards that you gain benefits when you have the tide. So really good, solid players online are actually now figuring out, hey, I don't need to take this tide, especially offset, every time. I'm not taking the chains for it. Mm-hmm. I'm going to look and see what is going to absolutely brutalize me. And at that point, that's when I take it. And there are key cards that definitely have an impact. I've seen quite a few kind of changes in that regard, but I wanted to put it out because I think a lot of people are necessarily missing, like, oh, I look and I go... Honestly, I find that anything kind of under 9 for speed, for efficiency, has had a very, very different impact versus what's above 9. And I don't know why that seems to be my threshold and just the DT decks that I have, but there is a night and day difference of these
my
decks just don't
to
move.
You on that is, isn't that true for off DT as well? Like I used to be known as like an efficiency snob or not, or whatnot, but the more we've played recent sets that are so much faster, who also have like purge mechanics like Infernus and Clone that like are punishing your opponent's deck to the point where even if they're fast and they cycle, like you're cycling and hurting your opponent's deck. Like I've found it much, much harder in the current meta than I used to play low efficiency decks. Like if it's not, if your deck isn't turning, if you're playing fewer cards than your opponent, because the cards specifically in MM is what I'm talking about, are so much better on play value, efficiency is seemingly wrecking people quite a bit more. And there are fantastic decks in Worlds Collide like that too, especially if you're talking about some of the Star Alliance decks out there where everything, every creature has a play effect too. I think that like that was always my slant, my style. I think that style is definitely more dominant in the meta than it used to be.
I feel like from last season's KFPL, I ran into quite a few no efficiency Coda things, and they were super scary because every card was so much value. Because, you know, like nobody was playing a low SAS stack. But you know, like they can just chunk themselves because the, you know, efficiency fixes bad draw, right? That's what, you know, efficiency really does, is it smooths out chunky draws. But those no efficiency decks, man, if they draw okay, it's just brutally bad.
And, brutally good or hard to beat them. And that's true for sure. Like my son owns a deck that has like 3 Deaths, Pixies, Nature's Call, Chota, Regrowth, 2 Control the Weeks. Like it's got all these great cards, but it's like a -1F deck. It's like literally if I draw this in this order, I win the game pretty much versus anybody, but if I draw this in this order, I lose the game pretty much against anybody. Like
it's, yeah, and then you're just kind of flipping a coin and it's not even a 50-50 coin, right?
Yeah So it's interesting that that's always going to be a thing, which we might talk about that in Survival next week. I think there is a place for those high roll, low roll decks. And we'll see where I think that could be. But anyway, back to Dark Tidings. So Ewok was talking about speed. I 100% agree. I think if it's low speed, you're going to feel it a little bit more in DT because you're going to, even in decks that have time manipulators that are a good ratio, you're still going to have times where you take the chains.
Yep.
If you have no efficiency, the chains hurt worse. They just do, especially in a set that does not have daughter or mother. If you have Zenzi, like that's huge, but you probably already have decent speed just by having that card. But not being able to increase your own draw is significant to the chain ratio to hand size. Things that I love competitively about Dark Tidings. I think Dark Tidings has the best creature control card in this game, and we mentioned it earlier, Grand Alliance Council from Star Alliance. Brutal. Especially if you have the Diplomat combo, which can turn your creature into a house that you don't even have. This is a game winning card quite often, and that is not meta specific, except for maybe not against Coda probably doesn't care if you kill their creatures most of the time. But in the current meta, what we're seeing is a lot of boards that matter, a lot of boards that hold Amber, a lot of boards that hold the Wincon. Being able to kill all of your creatures on the opposing side with one card that does not give you chains is gigantic. And there's a lot of decks that have two of those. I see them paired up quite often. And when I see it, I was like, heck yeah, this is the deck to play. Or if it's on the other side, it's like, okay, my board being jack, they're dead. Like, it's just going to die. Like, there's not, it's not red alert. It's very hard to play around it. You kind of got to play the creatures. Most of the time, like, other, I don't know. Thoughts on other very competitive elements inside Dark Tidings?
You guys have been having success with the reoccurring A. The reusable, like, reusable amber control of this in Shadows. Like, a lot of the creatures are reusable amber control. And again, paired up with Star Alliance, where you don't have to be on Shadows to use them, makes it very good. Now, just Shadows on their own, it's just like having Dodgers back in the day. You get back, you get stuck in this Dodger loop towards the end of the game where, or yeah, where you can only steal one, but it's the only way you can keep them off, and you're not pushing yourself far enough ahead to win the game. But with this set, with house cheating, you got to have the house cheating.
Star Alliance is pretty significant here.
Yeah, the Shadows cards are really good. Like, you know, we looked at Hobnobber and went, yeah, we'll have to see. Like, Hobnobber on the board is a major threat.
Yeah. Like, when he's talking about reusable, we're not going to go through exactly what they all do, but he's talking about Hobnobber. He's talking about Freebooter Fae. He's talking about the guy that takes damage. What's his name?
Hart Simpson.
Hart Simpson. In the end, I found Hart Simpson to be way better than we thought he was going to be in most games, even games where you think he might not be a play. I've rarely seen the person that played him be the one that gets the disadvantage of it, because again, especially if you're playing offset where we were thinking that he would be the worst, like, they have to take chains to do it, and they probably don't want to do that. Yeah, like, I think
that people are trapping themselves because they're taking three chains to get that one steal off of the Hart Simpson when they damage him. And you're like, OK,
yeah,
that's a good trade. Honestly, when we're looking at what you're gaining out of it, one amber or one steal, in my opinion, for three chains is not a good investment. And I still see a lot of people going too high in order to take the.
They're overvaluing.
Yes.
Taking the tie. Yeah. And yeah, people are getting burned by it. I've definitely seen it in games that I've played, games that I've watched. So I think that's pretty neat as far as the dark, the Shadows reusable steel.
So I want to go back to Star Alliance for a second. I think that the important piece for Star Alliance that I've seen is Star Alliance needs to have a board with other things. If you just put Star Alliance out because it comes early, you're not really helping yourself in DT. Having other houses where you can go ahead and house cheat, you're able to use other things, is extremely important. So not necessarily killing the whole board for a DT in Star Alliance, but actually making sure that your other houses are taken care of. That really, really diminishes the value that I'm seeing from Star Alliance. So that was a big piece. I also think little things like upgrades for Way of the Pixie for Untamed. I think that it actually gets around quite a bit of Infernus that I'm gaining quite a bit from it. And because I can put it on a creature that's already out that, frankly, you didn't think twice about, like, oh, I played Mollyhawk a couple turns ago and you've just kept it there. It did its work. Now, all of a sudden, it gains an amber plus an extra amber. And that becomes something that Infernus isn't just going to chew up and spit back out. That has played an impact when we're talking about that burst. Some of these lower A decks I've seen actually just going ahead, their amber, they can actually increase it by quite a bit by having these huge burst turns. That's important for me to be able to see.
Yeah. So far, competitiveness is amber rush from multiple houses. Being able to reuse the steel stuff.
It does seem to lack the key cheats to really make the amber burst sell, right? Like, it's hard, you know, like, especially offset, that amber burst starts to scare me a little more, where the big scaling amber is a little more present.
Well, correct, because what we're really looking at, I jumped over to Untamed, but Untamed, I'm looking at Chelonia. Okay, Chelonia is there. We can have the creatures to be able to utilize it and to have that burst. There's your Hunting Witch. Interestingly enough, I have not seen a lot of multiple Chelonia decks where all of a sudden you're having three Chelonia. That's just not what I have been running into, and so that's interesting as that common. But you don't have a way, you really have to have Keyfrog, and then you have to have Fangtooth to kill it. You can have some infighting. I mean, there's some hard things, but it's not
or Waste Not, right?
Yeah,
correct. But those aren't, you're looking at multiple card combos versus, hey, I just played Chota or I just played Key Charge. It was just so easy, and DT does not have that piece in order to Amber Burst and then take it. And so, yes, yeah, scaling Amber, I think against it is extremely important.
Mm-hmm.
So.
So that is the one of the big vulnerabilities.
Is there
that it is vulnerable to big killing Amber.
Any artifacts in this set that are as game deciding as there have been in previous sets?
I've seen one person so far, and I think they're on our team, that has fielded a very strong Ceaseforge deck. That if at some point in the game, he'll be able to land Ceaseforge, and most likely he will win from hand on his turn with a Keyfrog. If you don't understand what's going on and or are able to address that situation very quickly.
Okay.
But again, like, he does have a lot of archiving in that deck. So normally if he gets it early, he could just stash it. But that's not nearly on the level of like Quixel Stone or Jar or whatever, right?
Right. Well, I was going to say, what are the other two artifacts that I think the Oofbrecht device? Oombrecht?
Yeah, can't call the house thing.
That can wreck. Make a real big impact, especially playing against MM and Worlds Collide, where they actually want to often build a board and use it.
Yeah, and just call the same house over and over
again. I know I've seen some decks do decent things with that, but I don't know if it's really been an archetype yet.
Yeah, I've seen it played. I've seen it do some effects, but I've not seen it matter enough to call it a game like clinching type of thing that I would want to aggressively address or hold a Poltergeist for even. I can't really. I mean, there are some strange things out there. I think there's some cards that are really good offset, I guess. What's it called? Dry the River?
Dry the River's there. I mean, honestly, the artifact that's popping in my mind is Rooftop. Rooftop, especially letting you forge, like, then to be able to come back and take that away, that has had an impact in a number of the games that I've seen. And while it's not completely viable in every single deck, there is a pretty high percentage that I've seen where they're just able to pull it off. And just losing a key is huge. There's no question about it.
I did pull off it's so many cards and it's a crazy combo, but I did pull off the Dr. Rochter, Reckless Experiment, Pyswevin, and Unity or Discord combo in live play last week. That is borderline pretty much library access style pain as far as watching the opponent player, because that turn takes a long time. You're active the entire time, but what you're basically doing is you're playing Rochter, playing the special upgrade on it, you're playing Pyswevin, you're reaping with Py, you're drawing three cards, you're reaping with Rochter, you're putting Unity or Discord on top of your deck, then you're playing Unity or Discord to put Pyswevin and Dr. Rochter and the upgrade back in your hand. And since play reap is two things, you can do that three more times. And then the last thing you play is just not Unity Discord, some other action. So you end up reaping for six, getting three pips off the upgrade, drawing nine cards, and playing some other action from your discard pile. So that's pretty dang good. And that's in a lot. There are a lot of decks that have that.
Unity and Discord is just a very, very good guard.
That's exactly what I did. I 100% abuse Unity or Discord, and even if I didn't have the Pice weapon, it's still six amber. And at the very end, you use a different action, just not Unity or Discord. So even without Pice weapon, it's a combo that exists in a lot of decks. Basically, any groundbreaking discovery deck that has Unity or Discord can have a six amber from hand combo at some point in the game. That they, if you hold it or archive the pieces for it, they will not be able to stop you doing that. And if you happen to have Vice Weapon 2, that's some pretty busted stuff, because nine cards, nine amber, and another action is pretty extreme.
Okay, so we've kind of hit where most houses can make part of your good competitive deck. But we haven't really said anything about Unfathomable. Right, like the new house, and we've not once said this and Unfathomable is making a competitive deck.
This is where I was looking. I have seen competitive Unfathomable, but they are very, very rare in my opinion. And it is a control piece. It is a heavy, heavy control piece. Yeah. And you got to picture Unfathomable has two different outlets that they're really trying to go for. And so if you have a split on those cards, you're just not playing competitive. However, if you do have it, it can shut down the game. It really can.
Yeah, I guess
I do agree. Like if you have the double, like the maelstroms plus the brain drains plus the bubbles, that kind of stuff, like that, I think is way more competitive than the other slant, which can win you some games against some of the super board decks. The other slant is, I'm going to tap down everything you have. I'm going to keep it tapped. Occasionally, I'm going to kill everything that's tapped. And you're never going to get to use creatures, which there are some that out that at that, but we've talked about it a couple times. You are just mentioned it. Most decks are just a hodgepodge mix of these two things. And they aren't synergistic with each other at all, especially when it comes to I'm going to exhaust all your stuff, then I'm going to bubbles one of them. Like that, that's doesn't one of those two things didn't matter at all. Like, it's they don't play nice.
Yeah. So I mean, like the only place I've seen them doing much is when they're brain draining kinda at closeout, right? You know, like it's your lock up a key house.
I mean, the big two to me is brain drain and maelstrom are really dang good. At some point in time, if you play a deck with either of those two cards in the deck, one of those two cards is going to win you a game. Like, period. If you play enough, you'll be able to set it up and make it happen. You'll be able to take off the amber control with brain drain. They'll have eight big creatures on their board that literally have no A on them. You'll maelstrom, and you have three turns where you can forge whatever the heck you want. Like that's going to happen, and those cards are great. It's just, can the rest of your deck either play the good cards from out of house, which is very, very possible, or are there enough other mediocre to at least decent cards with the brain drains and the maelstroms to make up for you having to call it that house? And a lot of the times the answer is no.
So the other piece
are some that are yes.
The other piece, you were talking artifacts earlier. Whirlpool does stand out as an artifact that makes you think differently. When we first saw Curiosaurus, makes you think different. When we first, you know, went ahead and saw Quixel, it makes you think and play different. Whirlpool is one of those where you have to be aware of the game and kind of the what the deck can do. If it can capture onto a creature that is frankly low and then coming over to you, that is brutal. Absolutely brutal. But Unfathomable is going in multiple directions, and that's where I have a little bit of an issue with it right now.
I will admit that I like, because basically with like Quixel, Heart of the Forest, Curiosaurus, like there's a stage of the game when you're trying to process it where your brain just hurts, and then eventually you move on to like, I got this. I'm currently in my brain hurts stage of Whirlpoolness.
I'm on the other end. My experience with Whirlpool, I think it's a bad card, and you generally don't want to play it. Unless, I mean, if you're playing against a Coda deck or something where, you know, they have no capture, but it is just this stupid card that lets them capture all your amber on one creature and then hand it over every turn. And, you know, I guess there's just so much MM and even Worlds Collide out there that does that kind of thing, that captures a ton of amber.
Yeah, which would, I think we'd kind of mention when we first looked at the card, is there's just, there are really good capture lines in Dark Tidings, but I think there are also, like, Sori and Worlds Collide captures better than any house in any set, period. So, if you run into any of those Saurian decks, that's rough.
I don't know, I think MM can stack up Amber faster than...
Real, I mean, I guess Anthony. Yeah, Anthony would be pretty funny.
Well, just spoils and exalt takes a lot.
Yeah, but you can tribute exalt also in Worlds
Collide. Well, anyways, like, there's plenty of it between both of those sets. It doesn't really matter which one is better, right? But they can both just generate a ton of amber on their own creatures and then hand it over. So I don't know about Whirlpool. That one's not.
Well, but I think
there's definitely going to be legitimate Whirlpool decks where if you can't answer Whirlpool, it will end up being a problem. Because I've even seen, I don't know how many there are, but I have seen someone that was playing a Fangtooth Whirlpool deck, and that was pretty hard to deal with.
So I did play a Whirlpool Evil Twin deck, and I had the Evil Kaup. So I got to hand it over to my opponent, and then they can only play one of each type. And my argument that Evil Kaup's effect is worth it totally stands, because he beat me with my own Evil Kaup, because he basically used it, discarded his hand, and kicked my everything off the board, right? That effect is worth it. That effect can be worth it.
I was game on this state where, like, I think it could be valuable, because that is a lot of C.
And, like, playing one of each type of card isn't that penalizing. Like, how often are you... I mean, like, if your deck isn't a high F deck, how often are you really going, I got two creatures, two, two, and two? You're like, you know, you're one, one, and one, and you discard your extra creature, maybe. Like, I don't know. I think it's...
Well, Evil Kaup is a little different. It's, you can only play... Oh, well, no, you're right. One of each type.
Yeah, so Evil Kaup is... You cannot...
That bad.
Yeah, you can not play more than one card of each type each turn. Fight, reap, discard any number of cards from your hand. For each card discarded this way, deal two to an enemy creature.
Yeah. Yeah. Like,
I think he's pretty good. Anyways, there's that. And then we haven't touched on Saurians in Dark Tidings.
Well, cool. We're talking about competitive, right?
Oh, yeah, that's right. I got crushed by Saurian in Dark Tidings the other day, playing against Dark Tidings, and it's because he dropped four or five creatures that were all 5+ power, and like I said, like, this set can have no C, and that's what I had, and I'm just like, all my creatures are smaller than your 7 power, 2 armor guys 12, who kick my butt.
The 12 dudes. I'll give a little love to Saurian. I have done very well with Dark Tidings sealed Saurian lines. Because, again, if you're playing Dark Tidings sealed, a lot of the decks just don't have the C. They'll have a lot of A and no C, or they will have C, but either very little A. But either way, I've done competitively with Saurian inside Dark Tidings sealed. But if you go outside of a sealed environment where it's Dark Tidings versus Dark Tidings Archon, I don't think they're good enough there. I think you'll see the decks that have Grand Alliance Council, and they'll just go away.
So, having played it, do they not feel a lot like what Sanctum was in Coda?
I know I originally compared them to, like, the Brobnar Worlds Collide. They are definitely not as bad as that.
They're not that bad. I think they're I think they're much more in line with Sanctum and Coda, where, like, they build a big board and win.
Yeah, they have options. They actually do have a decent key cheat in a lot of decks, because... Imperial Forge
is
really dang easy to fire in this set, because Spoils of Battle, Medicus, City State, like, Reach Advantage, you capture a ton real fast in huge chunks.
I think that was the piece. Reach Advantage comes in multiples that I've seen, and with that and Bury the Riches, you can really get some value out of it. If you have Spoils, Reach Advantage, there are some decks that are there. I think Medicus Lacus is just honestly too easy that I'm going to take the three chains in order to make sure that you don't forge. So that really does hurt.
That is on par with Mecha Buoy, where offset, you're just taking chains to keep me from using this amber. Like it's still a good card. Like in some ways,
offset Mecha Buoy and Medicus are real good.
Yeah. I don't think after playing, I'm actually that much of a fan of Hydra Cataloger. Offset, it gives too much value to taking the thing. And onset, again, like you're just, I don't feel like I get more value than my opponent does out of it.
I'm fine with it offset. I think Hydra Cataloger is, unless you know you have them like manipulation advantage, like by a significant number, I see more issues with Hydra Cataloger played in set DT versus DT than offset. That said, Hydra Cataloger is a really good piece if you do have a good Data Forge deck. There are good ones out there. There's just no bonkers OTK ones that are super good that we were talking about. But there are several decks that can fire Data Forge way more in comparison to the previous sets for Data Forge.
I think the Colosseum is a better cheat in this set than it has been. Mostly because your dinos suck at doing anything else, but they're okay at fighting.
So the other piece that's been really odd for me is in Star Alliance, that static collection array. I've played offset and I've had more and more people that as I get, they'll actually use it to keep you off of key.
I've done a lot of thinking about static collection array because we kind of like Mecha Buoy. We thought it was going to be good offset. But because of stuff like Doorstep, Bring Low, TMTP, like, and even Graft, they can let you forge at five and take more. Like, Static Collection Array is just a bad card. It's not good. There's a lot of the good decks out there will love it if they can make your Amber cost seven at any point in time. Offset.
I was trying to decide if two of them makes it better or worse, but based off of what you were saying, probably worse.
Even worse. Because you're more vulnerable to Graft. You're more vulnerable the other way, the way that they actually control to TMTP and stuff like that. Like there are too many cards that already punish you from going high from the very Bates, which sucks now. But from the very beginning of A that scales to the very end, it is worse for you to play Static Collection Array most of the time against very good decks.
But it has an Amber Pip on it.
I know.
That's why we know that we play our Amber Pip.
Filing it away under like that speed sigil thing. In modern play, it's probably something you should be discarding unless you know exactly what you're doing with it. One of the people in the KFPL had a speed sigil deck that he played it to great effect versus Worlds Collide and MM, but he had a game plan. He knew exactly what that game plan was, and it won games for him. A lot of people that are playing speed sigil at random in whatever deck they're in don't have anywhere nearly as thought out as a plan for all the things he would do with speed sigil in every house. They just want extra reap value, and they don't understand that their reap value does not equate to a Star Alliance creature getting a play action and a reap action trigger in twice in the same turn.
I also think that when we're looking at Saurian, I don't place it as Coda Sanctum. I actually place it as a step below, but I do place it above Worlds Collide Brobner. I know that was earlier.
Got that same kind of play feel to it, where you just play a bunch of big creatures who don't do much.
I think they don't have the analogy armor. Probably stands for me. I put them with Brobnar Coda. It could be really good if you got all the play effect creatures with Wardrummer, or it could be really good if you got like Crump, Gauntlet, Headhunter, Fire Spitter, and all the Relentless Assault stuff. Like if all of Brobnar was doing the same goal, Brobnar was really hard to deal with. But again, most of the time, you got a few of the play effects, got a few of the fighters, maybe not enough fight triggers from hand, and it did random stuff.
In Sealed that one dino who, when he plays, he lets you exalt and reap with a non-Saurian creature.
Oh, yeah. Ooh. Yep. Magistrate or whatever it is.
That is some Magistrate real good, Vito. Real good house cheating there, too. Real good.
Yeah. No, I really love that card. I also like the Felix, the one that just exalts opponent stuff, like that's actually a pretty good dino because he does it on fight too.
And then you dino you didn't them.
Well, let me put this in. Magistrate Vita is 5 power Saurian. Play Reap. You may exalt a friendly non-sanctum creature if you do Reap with it. So that was what Sheep you were talking about.
That's another one where, like Star Alliance, you get him early and you like want to play your off house first because you're like, I want to use him when I play him.
Yep.
What was the other one that you guys were talking about?
Felix.
Yeah.
Philo? Is it Philo?
It's Philo. Yeah, Philo. Philo. And... All right. Physicist. Felix. Is that it? Where play fights. If the tide is high, you may exalt a creature.
Mm-hmm. I love it because it's also play fights. A 5-power dude like. Basically, he is in a way reaping on both effects. It's almost like a better headhunter type thing because the exalt is happening as long as you have stuff to kill. I've had, again, in sealed Dark Titans play, Magistrate, the Felix, the one you just talked about, have done very good for me, especially since Crushing Charge is in set. And most of the time, that kills the entire opposing board if they're Logos, Star Alliance, or Shadows. Like, killing everything for a blow does almost nothing to any Saurian creature, but kills almost all of Logo, Star Alliance, and Shadows.
This set could have really used Axiom.
It could have, but again, they'd already... we've still got Gateway.
I think the Saurian lineup needed to have something else to do with the Amber. I just still feel that it's an Amber battery. Okay, fine. I can go ahead and I can use it for Buried Riches. I can use it for Imperial Forge. But for the most part, man, I have a really nice fun deck with my Sanctum. And with my Saurian. And when you don't have your Bury the Riches, you're just sitting there like, yep, take all my Amber back.
Losing Scutum and Ludo... and Ideal, all three things being lost in the set transition was a pretty big blow to the story. Like if almost any of those had stayed, it would be a slightly different conversation. And if all three had stayed, I mean, I think the Sorin would be just as good as it was in MM, still worse than Worlds Collide, but just as good. But they're gone, so we feel that. We feel it immediately.
Even
it's not like
Curiosaurus could have fixed it.
Even Curiosaurus would have helped some. Yeah, like all of I'm curious, like that's 4 cards that we could name it, or even like Ancient Powered Imperium. Bring Imperium back or keep Ancient Power. Like, those are significant. Even if the Amber isn't protected, at least it is harder to deal with your board because it's not there. So, all right. I think that's what's competitive in Dark Titans. Are we saying Dark Titans is hugely competitive against the most competitive decks right now? No. But I will tell you, the number of decks that have been scanned in is way lower. Of course, so I don't know the actual numbers, even though I'm a math teacher. But anyway, it is way lower than comparative sets that we've been comparing it against. It's way lower than MM still, by drastically lower than Worlds Collide, AOA, and is just like a speck compared to Coda as far as decks scanned. As we get more decks scanned in, I expect to start seeing better SAS ratings and metrics of some of those decks and more decks showing up and surprising some old school good decks and wrecking them. Like, I think we will see some ultimate combo decks. I think we will see some burst decks that we just can't stop because they are bursting from 3 different houses. We talked about at the top of this segment. Like, I don't really, like, it would be hard to name a set that could super burst from 3 houses really easily. Like, I don't know. All right,
I will say one more piece for DT. What I have seen is a very, very low creature count consistently, and so that has an impact on the game too when you are playing. And so I think that's why I'm feeling some of that low C a little bit more. Some of the decks that I really enjoy, they're just lacking in the C. They're lacking, and then they don't have the creatures to back it up. So the combination, I put this in when we were looking at our short adaptive. If you have very low C and you have few creatures, that creates issues in my opinion. So kind of keep that in mind. You got some powerful pieces there, but how it's used for DT, it makes you think a little bit more. On the other note, I will say the card from earlier, why I suck at KeyForge, Abysmal Zealots. That's the card I'm shaking my fist at today. 4 power, Aquan, after you raise the tide, capture 2. You can't raise the tide if it's already high, my friends. So after your opponent raises the tide, move 2 from Abysmal Zealots to the common supply. So it happens, but yes, I do think DT is competitive. I don't think it's top level competitive, though.
And I agree. At the time, I'm hoping we're going to see some stuff like very early on. Like a lot of people forget what was out there and what was seen at the time. But I feel like around this time of AOA, we were saying the same thing. And right now, today, in the present world, I can point to like, I think my list is now 6. There are like 6 AOA decks in the world that can wreck tons and tons of decks that would be very hard to go up against no matter what deck you have. And that's saying a lot. Like, that is a significant thing to say, especially since very early on we were all really low on AOA. One of us at least still is. I hope it sells enough decks that get scanned in so that we can see what it truly can be.
I think that it will definitely beat the 6. I have no issue about that, but I think that it plays differently, and I think that SAS is not valuing how it plays. So you're seeing a couple different types of players kind of start to show up and play, but again, very, very mid-level, not necessarily high level, which is what some of us are looking for.
I'm so very much of the opinion that the play community overvalues Coda, and it's and its competitiveness to decks opened thing. Like, people think, I mean, like, when you look at the number of truly really good Coda decks versus the amount that are opened,
compared it's very
to
low.
Good MM to MM that is opened, like, it's clear. You buy MM decks.
Yeah, MM is producing high quality decks, like super high quality decks at a far superior rate than Coda. And like twice or triple that compared to AOA. Because while I can name like 6 AOA, I cannot name in any kind of list.
Yeah, right.
Number of devastating MM decks out there. Yeah,
between me and you, we have 6 MM decks that we think could do something.
Yeah, like it's the lit. Like they're every competitive team in KeyForge has great MM decks right now, multiple.
And I think this is why, again, this is why cycling back all the way around that we are looking at KeyForge Live being MM. We have 2 future topics, and one of those is MM sealed experience and kind of what to look for. With the limited play experience, MM sealed, there's a lot that you can open that can just be absolute banger.
We still have a really in-depth talk about playing a Archon MM deck live because, guys, there's tips on there. And guess what? You don't get to know where the pip is.
Yeah, but that is for another time.
Yeah. All right. That is us. Take us out, Dan.
Yeah, that's it. Remember, we're still playing Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday nights over on Archon's Corner. Also, Wednesday nights as well with Lokar through the Archon's Corner Discord. So if you're looking for other regular events, come check us out there. Sign up for live. Come play with us at live. If you can't play with us at live, tell everybody you know anyways to come play with us at live. Let FFG know that you're interested in these kinds of events. That's what we got going on.
Have a good week. Play KeyForge.
Stay safe, everyone. Play KeyForge. Have some fun.